is, and today we're reading come from Ephesians chapter 5. Therefore, be imitators of God, as dearly loved children, and walk in the way of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. But sexual immorality and all impurity or covetousness must not even be named among you, as is proper among saints. Let there be no filthiness, nor foolish talk, nor crude joking, which are out of place, but instead let there be thanksgiving. For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. As children of light, and find out what pleases the Lord. Have nothing to do with fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather expose them to the light. Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand that what the Lord's will is. Do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thanks, and we appreciate that, brother. So today we are starting a brand new series. We just finished basically like a six-month series where we were walking through the story of the Bible. And, you know, when you read the Bible, there are basically, especially in the New Testament, when you look at Paul's letters, or the letter that Peter wrote, or James's letter, you'll find two basic kinds of content in the New Testament. So one of those is theological, where they're talking about who is God, what is Jesus' death on the cross mean for us, what is salvation, theological kind of teachings in the New Testament. You'll find those there. Then the second thing you'll find in the New Testament, and you find this everywhere, is practical ways to live out this new identity that you have in Christ. Very practical messages. Now, the last 6 months, as we've walked through the story of the Bible, you've heard both of those things. This series that we're starting today and through the rest of the month is very practical. It's very practical. What we're going to do is take a look at Scripture, and we're going to help practically apply it to living out your Christian faith so that it isn't just stuff you know, but it's a way that we live together as a family and community as we follow Jesus together. So we all know what a guardrail is. You know what that is, right? A guardrail is a system designed to keep vehicles from straying into dangerous or off-limits areas. And again, you know this, those of you who are drivers, generally you find guardrails in three specific areas. You'll find guardrails at bridges, and medians, and at curves, generally, right? So a guardrail on a bridge keeps you from dropping off the other side of the bridge, right? A guardrail on a median keeps oncoming traffic from driving into you, or vice versa, right? And curves, a guardrail on a curve is because sometimes the road changes direction and we're not paying attention. And a guardrail on a curve keeps you in the lane in case you don't notice that the road has changed. So guardrails, when you encounter them, they do two main things. They direct and they protect, right? They direct and protect. And this next point is really critical for our discussion over the next couple weeks, guardrails are not placed in the danger zone. In other words, we don't stick the guardrail in the area where it's bad. We actually put the guardrail a little in the safety zone. It's placed inside the safety zone, just a few feet away from the danger. Now, if there wasn't a guardrail there, you could drive a little closer to the edge and you'd still be okay. But we all get the logic of why we place the guardrail in the safety zone and not in the danger zone, right? Because if you get too close to the edge, one mistake and you're in big trouble. So the guardrails are placed in the safety zone. And guardrails are designed to minimize damage. That's what guardrails are meant to do. Now look, I don't know if you've hit a guardrail. You don't have to raise your hand. You don't have to raise your spouse's hand. But if you hit a guardrail, okay, if you hit a guardrail, it's going to damage your vehicle. It's going to cause problems, okay? But it's way better than encountering what's on the other side of the guardrail. You know what I'm saying? It's going to damage your vehicle, but it's going to be way better than what's on the other side. So the reason this series is entitled Guardrails is because the highway is not the only place that we need guardrails. The highway isn't the only place we need those. go around the room right now, and people were honest, and you shared some of your stories about deep regrets and things from your past you wish you hadn't done or encountered, I am willing to bet that many of our greatest regrets could have been avoided if we'd had some guardrails in place to keep us away from those danger zones. Maybe it was a financial mess. You know, you made some bad decisions with money or racked up the credit card debt, and you just found yourself swamped and overwhelmed. If you'd had some guardrails in place that prevented you from getting into that danger zone, you might have been better off. Maybe it was a moral thing. You made some decision in hindsight. You're like, I don't know what I was thinking, and it led to just a snowball of a mess. Maybe it's relational, something in your marriage. You're like, man, if I had dealt with that years before instead of letting it fester, I really would have been in a much better place. Or maybe it's your job. It's something with your work, like something you said to your boss or the way you behaved on a job site. And you're like, man, if I would have had some boundaries in place ahead of time, I could have avoided that big mess in my life. So it stands to reason that if a lot of our past regrets could have been avoided if we'd have had some guardrails in place, it stands to reason that there are a lot of future regrets that can be avoided if we establish some guardrails now in our lives. And that's what this service is an appeal to do, this message series, is an appeal for all of us to think about our lives and set up some guardrails. Now, the challenge that we run into is that in our culture, guardrails are not encouraged. People don't like guardrails in our culture. In fact, they kind of make fun of them. Instead, what our culture prefers is like painted lines, dashed lines, gray lines, not guardrails, just suggestions, fuzzy boundaries. And in fact, if you set up guardrails in your life, there's a good chance that your family, friends, culture at large, they might give you a hard time about it. They're not going to encourage you when you set up guardrails. For example, in our culture, we hear things like, here's what our culture says, drink responsibly. That's what our culture says. Now, that sounds good. It's a good suggestion, okay? But what does that mean, to drink responsibly? And the problem is, once you've had too much to drink, you don't know what responsible is anymore, do you? That's the problem with it. It's a great guideline, drink responsibly. It's not much of a guardrail, okay? Or what about this one? Wait to have sex until you're ready. That's what our culture says. Wait to have sex until you're ready. My guess is a woman came up with that guideline. Because if you said to a teenage boy, wait until you're ready, they were born ready. Okay? The idea that you should wait until you're ready, that sounds good, but it's not much of a guardrail. It's more like a loose suggestion. And it leads to problems. It's a painted line. It's not a guardrail. Or consolidate your debts. Or maybe the worst one, listen to your heart. Right? That might be the worst advice ever. Because honestly, most of my problems are because I followed my heart. I followed my instincts, and they led me in terrible directions. So in our culture, there's a resistance to rules. We do not like rules in our culture. No, in fact, no one likes rules. No one likes being told no. And that's why we prefer painted lines. We don't like guardrails. That way we can cross them whenever it's convenient. It doesn't get in our way. But if you establish guardrails, friends, what I'm telling you today is you are not going to get any applause in our culture. Culture's not going to clap for you. But think about this. Our culture will line up to mock you if you drive off the road into a ditch. If you end up in a moral ditch, a financial ditch, a relational ditch, culture is not going to cut you any slack. And here's a great illustration of this, right? Those of you who know Billy Graham, he's passed away now, but Billy Graham is a famous preacher in the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, famous for his crusades. And Billy Graham had a rule that he followed, and Mike Pence, our former vice president, he followed the same rule. But Billy Graham had this rule that in order to safeguard his marriage and avoid temptation, he would not ride alone in a car with another woman, other than his wife or his family members. He wouldn't meet alone with a woman behind closed doors. He wouldn't even eat and drink in a restaurant, which is a public place, unless a lot of people knew about it. So it wasn't like a secret or what was he doing having dinner with that lady. Billy Graham had these rules to protect him from his own weakness and from any accusation that he'd done anything wrong, etc. Mike Pence, our former vice president, he had a similar rule. And when the media find out about it, when they found out about it, oh, man, he was ruthlessly mocked for this, that was stupid, and showed he lacked common sense and self-control. Even though a lot of married people have applied that rule in their own lives for years. And many of you in this room might say you follow that rule. I know I generally try to follow that rule as well. But at the same time that culture's mocking Mike Pence or Billy Graham about that kind of a rule, what do they say when a man commits adultery with a coworker? What does our culture say about a woman who runs off and leaves her family because she falls for her fitness coach? You see, culture will come down on you hard when you make mistakes. But if you set up boundaries, they'll also make fun of you for that. So you can't win with culture, which is why you kind of need to ignore them and do what is right instead of trying to appease the masses. So during this controversy with the Mike Pence rule and Billy Graham rule, Harvard Business Review, they wrote a really critical article about this Mike Pence rule and Billy Graham rule. And they actually wrote that this rule can harm women. That it can harm women professionally. We'll talk about that. They recognized the need. This was interesting. Harvard Business Review recognized the need for some kind of boundaries because they understood the basic point behind the rule. So what did Harvard Business Review recommend in place of the Billy Graham or Mike Pence rule? What did they recommend? If you had to guess, they recommended gray lines, painted lines, not guardrails. Here's what Harvard Business Review wrote. So what's an evolved male leader to do? In the simplest terms, become what we call a thoughtful caveman. I don't know what that is. I don't know what a thoughtful caveman is. It sounds derogatory. It's like one of those things that sounds like a compliment, but it's not. You know, I don't know what it is. But look, Harvard Business Review knew this, that there will be times when you are going to be in meetings, and there's going to be somebody there, men or women, and you're going to find somebody attractive. You're going to be having dinner with some people. There might even be some flirting going on. So become a thoughtful caveman. Okay, article goes on. Here's what they say. Healthy, mature, self-aware men understand and accept their distinctly male neural architecture. Again, I'm not even sure I know what that sentence means. I don't know how this is supposed to help us keep healthy boundaries in our work relationships so we don't end up in a mess. I don't think that's very helpful, honestly. But even if they're right on, even if this is absolutely true, ladies, just the ladies in our room, can I ask a question? Can I ask you a question? How many of those do you know? Some of you ladies in the room have never met one of those. In fact, some of you would say, if you find one, would you capture him so we can study him like a unicorn? Here's the biggest problem, okay, with the Harvard Business Review recommendation here. Here's their biggest problem. Those kind of guys don't need guardrails, but the other 99.99% do. And ladies, it's because of the other 99% that you need guardrails too. Now, as I said, I try to follow this Billy Graham rule. When I meet with people privately, I try to keep my door ajar, let other people know I'm meeting with somebody. I try not to get in a car alone with another woman, not because I distrust women or I'm nervous about women, but because I want to be above reproach. I want to make sure that people are aware of the way I'm conducting myself and that I'm living in a way that brings honor to God and to the women I'm meeting with. This rule is definitely misunderstood and misapplied. There are dangers to this rule. We'll talk more about that in a couple weeks. But the point of all of this is, if you choose to set up guardrails, you will not be celebrated by our culture. But I guarantee you, if you set up some guardrails, you will have a lot fewer regrets. You will have a lot fewer regrets. Now, establishing guardrails is not a new idea. The Bible has encouraged us to set up guardrails for many, many years, standards and boundaries. And today what I want to do is take you to the book of Ephesians. I'm going to take you to Ephesians. We heard Nuni read Ephesians 5 earlier. Take you to the book of Ephesians because Paul knows that his readers need some help to avoid going off the edge of the bridge. Paul knows that his readers need guardrails in their life. So I want to look at Ephesians 5. Let's jump into the text this morning. Paul begins Ephesians 5. He says, be very careful then how you live. Paul has some great advice here in Ephesians. The word live can also be translated walk. Be very careful how you walk. Any of you own dogs in here? How many dog owners we got? Okay, got dogs. Any of you also have a small backyard? You understand what it means to walk carefully. There are landmines everywhere. Okay? This is what Paul is saying. He is saying that we all have a small yard and some dogs, and there are landmines all over the place in life. You've got to walk carefully. And if you understand Paul's advice, listen to how he keeps going here. He continues. He says, be very careful how you live, not as unwise, but as wise. Wisdom, the word wisdom in the Bible is such a critical word. So often the Bible doesn't talk just about doing what's right and not doing what's wrong. It talks about living wisely. Living wisely is like the biblical standard for living well, okay? God wants you to walk wisely. And you, there will be many times in your life when you won't know what is right and wrong. Like, it's just a gray situation. I don't know if it's right or wrong. That's why wisdom is such an important standard to make decisions in your life. So when you ask yourself, what is the wise thing to do in this situation? It brings a lot of clarity. A lot of clarity if you can just ask, what's the wise thing for me to do? A good way to ask this question. In light of my past, because everybody's got a different past. Your past is different from the people around you. In light of my past, in light of my current circumstances, and in light of my future hopes and dreams, what is the wise thing for me to do in this situation? My past, my present, and where I want to go in the future, what is the wise thing for me to do? Then Paul says this, make the most of every opportunity. In other words, Paul says you have limited time in your life, and you don't know when it will be gone. You can look on your phone today and find out how much money you have in the bank, but you do not know how much time you have left in life. So Paul says, be aware of the time and make the most of the opportunities that you have today. Then Paul gives the reason for all of this. Listen to what he says. Make the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. We're living in dangerous times. Now, Paul's writing this 2,000 years ago, but my goodness, he could have been writing to us today, couldn't he? He is writing to us today. We live in evil days. You've got to be careful. You can't afford to live carelessly. It's like defensive driving, right? When you teach your, those of you that have gone through this, you've taught your kids to drive, you've been in driving school, it's not enough just to teach them how to drive. Make sure they're following the rules. You also have to teach them to watch out for all the other people, don't you? You have to teach them to defensively drive. You got to look out for the other drivers. That's Paul's point. It's not enough just to watch yourself. You also got to watch out for all the other people in your life as well. And he concludes this short passage with this. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. Don't be foolish. In other words, don't think that your decisions today aren't going to impact your future. They are, right? So understand what the Lord's will is. Face up, pay attention, be honest with yourself. You know yourself better than anybody else. You know your situation. You know your past and your temptations. You know that about yourself. So face up to the truth about it and be honest. What does it mean? What it means to live in Christ? What does it mean to live for you in that new identity that God has called you to? You know what you need to do. You know when you're driving over the line. You know that. Where you're flirting with disaster. Where you've had some near misses in the past. You know that. Now, what Paul is doing with this little section of the text, he's building a case. And the case he's building is this. The reason we need to be so careful is because one thing leads to another. One thing leads to another. You know this in life, right? Every step you take takes you towards something and away from something else. And guardrails, if you set them up, they will keep you from stepping off the road towards what will harm you, towards what comes next. And then in this next section of the text, Paul gives a very specific example of what it means to set up a guardrail and walk in wisdom. Listen to Paul. He says, Ephesians 5, this is verse 18, do not get drunk on wine. In the ancient world, okay, so you got to go back 2,000 years now. In the ancient world, wine was actually safer to drink than water, right? Water could be poisonous. It could have bacteria in it, and you wouldn't know it until you drink it, and then you're dead, right? But because of the alcohol, wine was safer than water. So wine was the most common drink in the ancient world, especially when the water was a little nervous, made people nervous. Wine could make you drunk, though. That's the problem. But water could make you dead, so you kind of had to choose, all right? Now, what Paul is saying here, clearly, is the Apostle Paul and the church for several thousand years now, there's nothing wrong with drinking wine. But this is a one thing leads to another kind of situation, isn't it? In other words, don't get drunk on wine. Why? Because Paul says, listen to him, it leads to something. It leads to. And I bet every one of you could fill in that blank. Don't get drunk on wine because it leads to. You don't have to say it out loud. You just think it in your head. Some of you know firsthand. What comes to your mind? Does a person come to mind? Does a thing come to mind? Do you know anyone who found out too late? Do you know anyone who found out the hard way that getting drunk should have been a guardrail? They should have had a guardrail set up there. Some of you listening to me right now, your life today would have been completely different if your mom or your dad had stayed sober. It's true. Many of us have been there. And that's why we don't say this very often, but I'm just going to say this morning, this is probably a good time to say this. That if somebody in your life, if more than one person has mentioned that you drink too much, you do. It's really quiet in here all of a sudden. A little bit heavy. Let's jump back to Paul. Let you off the hook there, but this is a good time to be thinking about this, all right? So, back to Paul. Paul says, don't get drunk on wine because it leads to something. The problem with getting drunk is what it leads to, all right? Drunk is the guardrail. Now, I know for some of you, drunk is the goal, okay? It's not supposed to be the goal. For Paul, it's the guardrail. You're supposed to keep you from going there, okay? So, getting drunk seems fun, all right? Right up until the point that a woman gets in. Right up until the point that somebody drives over the median when they're going home that night. Right up until the point that a college student realizes everybody else can stop drinking and they can't. See, then it's not so fun anymore. In light of my past experiences, my current circumstances, and my future hopes and dreams, what is the wise thing for me to do? What is the guardrail I need to establish to help me live wisely and avoid foolish choices? Remember, the culture is going to mock you for this. All right? They don't care about your guardrails, but they will turn on you as soon as you have a drinking problem or you get in trouble. And Paul says getting drunk leads to, his word here, debauchery. Now, that's a word we don't really use. Debauchery means an indulgence that comes from a lack of self-control. That's what that word means. Usually this is sexual. Sexual loss of control. But it can be other kinds of loss of control as well. And the choices that come with it. Don't get drunk on wine because your choices are going to be reduced because you won't be thinking clearly. You're going to be making bad choices. That's why guardrails are so important for all of us to establish in our life. Guardrails safeguard you from handing over control of your life to someone or something else. Guardrails will safeguard you. They'll safeguard your husband, your wife, your kids from being controlled by something else. They'll keep you from living with regret in your life and from looking back with regret because of bad decisions you made. That's what a guardrail will do for you. Guardrails exist so that you won't be mastered by anything in your life. Anything in your life. So Paul says, instead, don't get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, this is where Paul's transitioning now. If you are not a Christian and you've been listening so far, you might be nodding along going, yeah, okay, I get this. There's wisdom here. Now Paul's going to make a switch to talking specifically to Jesus followers. Here's what he says to those of you who call themselves followers of Jesus. Here's what Paul says. Instead, be filled with the Holy Spirit. The New Testament teaches that if you have that you have a new identity in Christ. You're baptized, you're redeemed, you're called, you're saved. God has brought you back home again, and now you have a new identity. The Holy Spirit comes to live within you now. And we experience, all of us, we experience the Holy Spirit primarily through our conscience, right? And so what Paul is arguing is that we need to submit our lives to the nudging, the promptings of the Holy Spirit. Everybody has a conscience. And when you become a Christian, as you read the Bible, as you are influenced by Christian friends and community, your conscience begins to get fine-tuned to hear and acknowledge the nudging of God, right? As you begin to listen to the Holy Spirit, your life begins to conform. So Paul is encouraging you, friends, this morning. He is encouraging you and me, all of us, to be wise and to know our weak spots well enough to establish clear boundaries and listen to the Holy Spirit. So here's a basic summary of Paul's argument so far, okay? Here's what he says. Be very careful then how you live. Do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. For the next few weeks, what we're going to do is look at some very specific guardrails that would be helpful for all of us to establish in our life. Look, nobody plans to wreck their life. Nobody plans that. Nobody plans to wreck their career, their marriage, their finances. We don't plan that out. The problem is we don't plan not to. We don't set up boundaries to keep ourselves from falling off the bridge. Guardrails are how you set yourself up to walk wisely and live carefully in this world. Now, how many times have you heard somebody say, or maybe you've said it yourself, don't worry, I'll be careful. Have you ever said that to your mom? Don't worry, I'll be careful, okay? Your kid said it to you? Setting up guardrails is how you be careful, right? Guardrails are defensive living. And there's another benefit. Remember earlier that I said that you'll find that even if you're new to faith or becoming a new disciple of Jesus, it is much easier to discern God's will for your life if you have guardrails in place than without them. Guardrails will direct and protect you. Pastor Paul talked a couple weeks ago about how God's law serves as a curb and a guide. That's what guardrails do. They help keep us on the road and off the edge of the ravine. The reason that these guardrails are so helpful in discerning God's will is because of this. And every time you step away from what can harm you, that's a step toward the one who loves you. Every time you step away from what will harm you, God has warned us about, when you step away from that, you step towards the one who loves you. This series, Guardrails, is not about becoming a better person. This is not self-improvement. This is about becoming surrendered people. People who surrender to the wisdom and will of God for their lives. People whose lives reflect and represent our Heavenly Father and the call of the Holy Spirit. Setting up guardrails is about surrendering to the God who redeemed and whose spirit lives within you right now. So for the next couple weeks, we're going to highlight some guardrails that we need to live wisely. And so the question I ask you today as we close is, where are some areas of your life where you need to set up some guardrails? You probably already know the answer to that. We're going to talk about specifics in the future. But for today, it's enough to say, where are some areas in your life where you need to set up some guardrails? And I pray that over these next couple weeks, starting today, you would be open to establishing some guardrails, submitting your life to the will of the Holy Spirit, your Heavenly Father, and protecting yourself from the things you know will harm you. Don't miss next week. And especially if you have teenagers, can I just beg you to have them in the room the next 2 weeks? Bribe them, take them to lunch, buy them their favorite pair of AirPods, I don't care what it is. Get your teens in the room the next 2 weeks, okay? Let me pray for you. Heavenly Father, we just want to come to you this morning. We want to thank you, first of all, that you have given us your law. So often, Lord, we view your law as something oppressive and to be avoided, and it just takes the fun out of life. And, oh, God, I feel guilty. But, Lord, the law isn't just about guilt. The law is also about protection. You want us to be protected from the ravines and the medians and oncoming traffic. You want us, Lord, to be safe. And so you've given us your law to keep us out of the ditch. And I just ask, Lord, that over these next couple weeks, all of us would be willing to surrender our lives, submit our lives to the goodness of your law, the purity of what you're calling us to. Because we all have past regrets, and we wish we'd have made different choices. God, you want us to avoid future regrets as well. And so beginning today, Lord, fully forgiven, redeemed, called, saved. We're your children. Lord, would you help us to live that out by establishing some guardrails to keep us out of the ditch? Father, may your spirit lead that in our hearts over these next weeks. In Jesus' name, amen. I invite you to stand. Oh, you know what I forgot? I'm going to invite you to stand anyway. This is appropriate. I want to close with the Lord's Prayer. I want to close with the Lord's Prayer. And especially the section of the Lord's Prayer where it says, lead lead us not into temptation. You know, one of the ways that prayer comes true is when you listen to God and establish guardrails so that you don't fall into temptation. So let's pray the Lord's Prayer together, and especially listen.